Live from Copenhagen, Denmark, it's theCUBE, covering KubeCon and CloudNativeCon Europe 2018. Brought to you by the Cloud Native Computing Foundation and its ecosystem partners.
Hey, welcome back everyone, live here at Copenhagen, Denmark, CUBE's coverage of KubeCon 2018 in Europe. This is all about the Kubernetes, the future of cloud native, Cloud Native Con, part of the CNCF, Cloud Native Foundation. I'm John Furrier with my co-host Lauren Cooney, founder of Spark Labs, industry expert in open source. We got two end user customers of Kubernetes and Cloud Native, Zach Arnold, software engineer, Wygree. Energy Fund, and Austin Adams, software development manager, same company. You guys are doing really interesting business model around energy and equity in buildings and homes, but you're writing code, so you have to like make all this stuff work. So I'm sure, you know, you're cloud native.
Right.
You know, why have a data center when you can have the cloud?
Exactly. We're born in the cloud.
You're born in the cloud. So take a step through. Explain the business real quick, and then what's your back-end technical scaling situation look like in terms of infrastructure, software, and what's the makeup of the systems?
You know the business best, yeah.
Yeah, so Wygreen operates under something called PACE, Property Assessed Clean Energy, and it's we operate in a couple of different states. We work with local governments to create a PACE program that is accepted in different counties or jurisdictions within the state, and then we allow homeowners and contracting companies to provide financing for home improvements that are specifically within the domain of renewable energy or energy efficiency.
So you basically finance like a solar panel I put on my house or building, there's benefits there, and then you guys get the financing and you tie in with the government, so the property taxes, the leverage, or the security is the building, right, or the asset.
Yeah, and the way that we're chartered is basically we can put a tax on the property, which gives us some guarantees on repayment and things like that. And it's a great model so far.
So new financial engineering around energy efficiency. So you got to build systems. So you're working with governments. So now, you know, we all know how government systems work. So you got to be agile and nimble.
Right.
Take us through how the back end works. What's it look like? What's the system look like?
Yeah.
You host it in the cloud, is it Amazon, Google?
So everything that we have is in a cloud provider that starts with an A and ends with an S. It's AWS, and I don't know if I can say that. I think I can say that.
Yeah,
AWS all the way.
Thank you.
And we have tons of services. We have Kubernetes running most of our main services. In our migration, we actually started with our main service. A lot of people start with their smallest microservice. We just went whole hog and just went in for it. So the system is mainly a loan management system and underwriting data aggregation and underwriting processing. So every application that comes in, we have to underwrite it and make sure every little thing checks out. And our underwriting system has won awards for how accurate it is and how high quality it is as well.
So I'm doing a mental whiteboard in my mind, just kind of grokking this, so just help me out here and take us through this. So you guys are a cutting edge company, new and progressive business model, real innovative, great stuff. Cloud native, so you're born in the cloud, no data center, cool, check.
Right.
And that's what everyone does. And now you're like, okay, I got to deal with these legacy systems. So you're putting containers around things, so you have to interface, you build your own system, so that's cool. But are you dealing with other systems? And then how are you handling that? Are you just containerizing it? So take us through some of that, those linkages.
Yeah, so we're creating, a lot of times when we have to integrate with another system, we'll create a small service that is code that we own. And we'll reach out to those integration, those vendors, and we'll do aggregation within our system and provide an interface back to our systems. You know, like everyone, we're breaking up the monolith or whatever. Maybe in 10 years we'll go back to a monolith, who knows. But you know, we're slicing out things, making microservices. It looks like, you know, a mess on the back end, just tons of microservices going everywhere. And that's why we're using all these cloud native tools to be able to manage that. So in order to move quickly, we're wanting to containerize everything. Everything runs in a container at this point.
Great.
A lot of our services follow this kind of, we're kind of calling the container adapter pattern. It follows the software adapter pattern where, just like Austin was saying, let's say for example, we're interfacing with a credit vendor, we create a service where we talk to our own service that has a well-defined interface that we know will always get a credit report back with the following fields. But then where that information actually comes from, whether it's one of the big three credit vendors or someone else who has a well-defined API, that's largely not the concern of the main loan management system. It's the concern of the microservice that's responsible for reaching out to that other entity.
Yeah.
So that's how we've kind of gotten to beat around the legacy interfacing of all of these other different financial services and tools that help to aggregate data.
So it's super clever. You can optimize on a service basis, but now you have to orchestrate and kind of conduct everything through. And that's where you're looking at Kubernetes.
Secure.
Yeah.
That's really interesting. I mean, I think what I'm looking at here is a huge ecosystem of, you know, partners and companies and end users coming together. And one of the questions I have is, you know, beyond why you are here, what are you looking at here? What is interesting to you? What do you want to learn about that you might bring into your, you know, architecture, essentially?
Austin and I were talking about this. We kind of tend to look at the CNCF list of projects as a dinner menu.
we're refreshing that page frequently because we're adding projects at an alarming rate. Mm-hmm. But one project we're using FluentD, Notary, Kubernetes, of course, Prometheus, things like that. We want to start using those things more extensively. Ones that we're really excited about are Spire and Spiffy, the identity, kind of a new take, not necessarily new, but new for cloud native take on identity of services and authentication, as well as the open policy agent to provide a single DSL to do all of your policy and authorization.
That's a lot of workload management and identity, correct?
Yes,
so that's
exactly
what they do.
Authentication and authorization are two of the most important things that happen in our system, and we have so many different ways that it happens right now, and it can tend to look a little clodgy just from the sense of the fact that we need a little bit more coordination or standardization around it. I mean, we have well-written policies that are documented, but the way that those actually get enforced are, it's individualized based on the service. You know, if it's a cloud-based policy, then it's AWS IAM. If it's a Kubernetes-based policy, it's RBAC, using Kubernetes RBAC. So it kind of looks like if we can abstract a lot of that functionality out of the services, the containers, the orchestration tool, or the cloud, to making those decisions, that would really, really simplify things greatly for us.
And you guys are end users, so are you part of like an end user group that gives feedback directly into the community, or how does that work?
We're on the fringes of the contributor community as well.
Great.
And we're definitely on GitHub in all of these projects, posting issues, and in some cases providing our own, you know, PRs or whatever. None of us are within the Kubernetes org, but definitely that's something we all are aspiring to be, is jumping into some of these projects, especially some of the smaller projects that we're using on a daily basis in our build servers, like Portieris or Notary. Some of those things, we're actively contributing to those.
So you're contributing where it matters for your product, but being active on the project is key.
Yeah.
The balance there.
Yeah, I mean, typically what you find in the finance industry is when they go for a solution, they lead with their wallet. As for what we can purchase or what we can sponsor. But Wygreen has been, our managers and management have been incredibly empowering in this way. They say, well, what can we give? We leave with our hands.
Yeah, and this is interesting. If you have a good business model innovation, which you guys have, you can be completely clean sheet of paper to build it.
Right.
So, you know, that's the best thing about the cloud.
Yeah.
You can really move fast and go from, you know, point A to point B, move the needle.
Yeah, and at the same time that there's kind of a clean slate, there's even a clean slate in terms of best practices within our industry. Now, if we were in mortgage, there's a lot of rules, there's a lot of clear guidelines on how to do security and auditing and things that you need. Whereas in our industry, that's all emerging. So we have a chance to also set the pace, set the tone for what security might look like or what cloud usage might look like within the PACE industry. But at the same time, we're getting increasing government regulation, so we're having to make these decisions around what are the tools that are going to help us achieve, you know, maximum customer protection and auditability while maintaining our business model and without, you know,
totally. And you're going to need flexibility because you don't know what's going to come next.
Exactly.
You got to be ready for anything.
Yep.
And so that's at least my next question. Two points. How do you guys prepare for what's next? What's the main ethos around technical architecture around being prepared for that ready state that's coming to you? And then two, what have you learned over the, what's the scar tissue look like? What's the what's the moments of joy and despair going on? Because you know, you're iterating, you're learning, you're always constantly getting knocked down, getting standing back up. So this is what innovation is. It can be fun and also grueling at the same time.
Go ahead.
So how we deal with what's new beyond our like software process. We have a well-defined process that everything gets churned into. Government's really good about giving us notice when stuff's going into effect, so we always have target dates that we're going toward. But in terms of what's next in terms of our software, we have this interesting culture within our organization. Everyone wants to improve everything. I think it's called a Kaizen culture, Kaizen culture. Just people are looking at stuff, they want to improve it. And so our process allows for anyone to throw something on the backlog. It'll get prioritized and put around, but we're allowing all of our engineers to say, hey, we want to do this. And, you know, putting it into an open forum where, you know, we might not do it, but we have the discussion. And we have all the channels to have those discussions. And like most technology companies or technology-focused companies, we spend a lot of time talking about technology and making those decisions.
So it's important you guys really have the cultural ethos, the people,
yeah. Right.
To be, look, debate, yeah. And then commit.
Exactly. And that's one of my, you know, recommendations for any company trying to move to cloud native or Kubernetes is always you have to have your evangelists on your team. And because you can't expect people who have been doing it one way forever to instantly be on board. You need some sort of technical evangelist, whether that's outside company. It works best, I think, if it's someone you've hired or someone in your organization who's preaching the gospel of Kubernetes or cloud native.
Yeah, that's Spark Labs, Lawrence company is doing a lot of that work. But that's really nails it. I mean, you gotta just, it's not a technical issue per se, it's really cultural.
Yeah, people. Exactly.
We've heard that all through the show here.
Yeah. Right. it's all about people.
All right, so what's on your wish list? What does the holidays want to bring for you guys? If you could throw a wish list out there and you can magic wand, crystal ball.
AKS. Yeah. Or EKS.
EKS, yeah. If Amazon could respond Kubernetes to our engine. Request. Yeah.
Okay, we just had Adrian on yesterday. He said it's coming. I said
it's coming.
He said months, so not.
Did you say
weeks.
Months? I thought it was. I thought it was a few months.
We'll
so maybe
check, we'll check the transcript.
All right. Months.
Yeah. It wasn't tomorrow.
yeah, that's all right.
Yeah,
and that's one of our scar tissue, right? Is we're doing this ourselves. You know, there's this huge control board, and we got people, you know, doing the knobs and things, and we're relatively small. You know, we're a small engineering organization, so we're doing a lot of this stuff ourselves where we can abstract a lot of that work out to a cloud provider that we're already on.
Well, it's going to be good reps for you guys as this thing gets abstracted away. Yep. You're going to have a great core competency in Kubernetes. I think that's a notable thing there.
For sure.
One of the things on my wish list, I was speaking with Jace and Josh Berkus and a lot of the core contributors to Kubernetes at the Contributor Summit, and I was talking to and what I kind of realized is I would love to see a coordinated cross-cutting effort either on part of the CNCF or on part of the Kubernetes project proper to have a proactive security, I wouldn't call it a working group, I guess a SIG, a special interest group. It would be, you know, because I know that we can deal with zero-day issues really, really quickly. For example, the Azure host path mapping issue that was a few months ago. But right now, it's kind of on the responsibility of each SIG to implement whatever security looks like to them individually, which is great. It means that there's people thinking about security. That makes me sleep better at night. But seeing some coordination around that and kind of driving towards, okay, we have this tool that seems to be changing the game. How are we going to change the game with security? Like, is there a way to look at that and even, you know, because authentication and authorization have been around since more than one user used a terminal in the 1960s and 70s. But, I mean, even with just this new step of admission controllers where we have more fine-grained control around how stuff gets into the cluster, I think it would be great to look at what a coordinated cloud-native security effort would look like.
I think that's great. I mean, we've been talking to a lot of vendors here and a lot of folks that have projects, and bring up security every single time, and they kind of have an answer, but they really don't.
You. Yeah, whoa, yeah, well, yeah, we got that.
Or, you know, you're the developer, you have to build it in yourself, right. So I totally agree with that recommendation. Yeah. I think it's fabulous.
Yeah.
Yeah, Kubernetes is making so many things simpler at certain levels. Now, if we can focus those efforts on making security simple for people, because they're security experts. They can put their two cents in.
Well, let's build it in and not block it on.
Build it in and not expect every developer to know.
It I like that, good. Yeah. Don't bolt it on, build it in.
Yeah.
Build it from the beginning. And there's all kinds of new ways. I mean, the fact that there's no perimeter with the cloud brings up, really kind of throws everyone for a loop because you have to go to the chipset down. I mean, what Google got, as I think, is a very interesting approach. They're trying to push forward this multi-layer approach from chip to kernel, OS to app. interesting, and they got, you know, managing through all their security practices. They got Android. I mean, spear phishing is a huge problem right now. We're seeing in a lot of enterprise we talk to, it's like, you know,
right.
It's just like, you know, firewalls and VPNs, like, that's old school.
Right.
They need to modernize it. So this is gonna, we're thinking about that. So, great. Well, hey, guys, thanks for coming on and sharing your feedback and your data at your place, and how you're architected on AWS, and your work in Kubernetes. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Right. Thank you.
Cube coverage here in Copenhagen. This is theCUBE's coverage at KubeCon 2018. We'll be back with more after this short break.